90s.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't have a strong connection to him. I just like what they now call the elderly. It's like I'm suddenly getting into that age bracket. I'm quite elderly, my butt. I am not.
Yeah. Yeah, forget that one, even with AARP writing.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, well, forget that one. But there, that's a whole other part of Kinsey's life, these people.
This is her family.
Yeah.
Insofar as you can pick and choose your family at her stage in life.
Then, I mean, I love the whole way that she discovers that Audrey was part of a whole thing with Dante.
Yes.
That he's still running for his father.
Yes.
And in this great estate in
Montebello.
Montebello. Yeah.
The research was fun for me because shoplifting is what they also call organized retail theft. It is big business. $30 billion a year losses.
That to me was, I didn't know. I mean, you think of someone, well, they'll take a candy bar. But this is really a whole where they then cut off the price tag, put it in the bathroom, the ladies' room or men's room. And now, what do you mean? I bought this.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's a tricky business too because retailers can't afford to falsely accuse a loyal shopper. They're reluctant to embarrass.
They don't want to get sued.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So there is a very fine line, and they're very careful about surveillance and monitoring someone they suspect is shoplifting.
You carry that out in the book because they had to be outside the door of the store, and then the man in charge of it could say, "Excuse me, ma'am,
would you come back in with me?"
Yeah.
Well, it was interesting from my perspective, again, I use that word, because I got to see the backside of store security. Yeah. So I got to go into the room with all the monitors. I got to watch people walk through what is actually Paseo Nuevo Mall in Santa Barbara, Santa Teresa, I call it passages.
Yeah.
And I learned a lot more about shoplifting and shoplifting strategies and the security measures to
and the way they get the cash at the way at the house that she goes to visit. Where was that, in like Capistrano?
No, it was in up in San Luis Obispo.
Uh-huh.
So sometimes I use the real name of a town. I use Lompoc, San Luis Obispo. Yeah. But many of these organized rings have sort of safe houses where they go and clip and then they redistribute it so that the stolen merchandise is not being offloaded in the community from which it was stolen. So they'll ship goods back and forth.
Meanwhile, back at the ranch, Nora and Channing are having a couple for dinner where the wife has been really Nora's best friend, but she's bored with hearing about how the husband is cheating, and she stops and is very mean to her, and they don't see the couple for a while. But there is one night when Nora says to Channing, "I called your office and Thelma wouldn't cut me a check." Now, that's a great expression. For $8,000.
Yeah. Well, Thelma was another fun character to deal with. Thelma is Channing's secretary, and when he hires her, she's a little plump, and she, you know, her teeth are not quite nice, and so Nora meets her once and feels quite superior, I suspect. Meanwhile, Thelma has worked for Channing for 2 years and undergoes a transformation. So by the time Nora realizes the two of them are involved, Thelma's quite the little knockout.
But I love how you did it, Sue.
Thank you.
Somebody left her an LA magazine, and in the back is the social who was at what party and pictures.
I always look at those.
Yeah.
And they're usually about this size, and generally they have a format. Everybody's standing, posed, they're smiling, they have their drinks. When Nora looks at this sheet of small photographs, the only one in which a companion is looking at her date that catches her attention, and she realizes it's Thelma looking adoringly at her own husband.
In her own Gucci dress. That killed me.
I know, Thelma is pushing the outer limits there.
Yeah. And lo and behold, our friend Nora says, that's it. And she goes, they have two houses, yep. One in Malibu and one in Montebello.
Right.
And the one in Malibu is up on the hill, and she doesn't really like the house that much, but Channing had it, which is something Dante points out to her.
Yes.
Everything's still in his name, and they always say it's for tax reasons.
Exactly. Oh. Well, it's funny hearing you describe the story. I think, this is so complicated, I'm getting lost. But I do lay it out very carefully, and so I don't think the reader is ever confused about who's doing what to whom.
It's that LA Magazine helps.
Yes.
Yeah. And so from there on, and it's, what is she going to do, really, with the rest of her life or with Channing?
Yeah. Well, and I think that's a decision a lot of women face, you know. And probably men as well. You find out your spouse is being unfaithful, now what?
Yeah.
Do you swallow your pride and live with it, or do you file?
Or is Peggy Lee saying, is that all there is, my friend, then keep dancing.
Exactly.
Yeah. When you are plotting it, where do you begin?
Each book is different, and I say often, I'm trying not to repeat myself, so I keep charts in which I note the gender of the killer, the gender of the victim, the motive for the crime, mm-hmm. and the nature of the ending to the story. And I also keep a chart of what I call setups. Who hires Kinsey Mulhone, and what is she hired to do? Mm-hmm. When I start a new book, I have to go through and look at all of that to make sure that I'm not unconsciously repeating myself. Mm-hmm. There is a tendency to do what feels comfortable and familiar.
Yeah.
And I am determined to steer off of that. So at the beginning of a book, I review what I've done.
Yeah.
And then I look for a subject that might generate action and humor and suspense.
Well, I love when she is asking, the question is, what am I accused of doing? You want to hear the list? And she says, of course. Income tax evasion, filing false returns, failing to report offshore bank accounts and international income. Also, racketeering, conspiracy, money laundering, interstate transportation of stolen property, sale of stolen goods. That about sums it up. Oh, mail fraud. I don't think I mentioned that. There might be a few I forgot, but most are variations on a theme.
That's Lorenzo Dante, who knows his days are numbered. And he is at an age where he is beginning to lose his edge. He knows he should whack his brother Cappy. Cappy is just an evil fellow and without much sense and dangerous because of that. But Dante can't do it. And he knows the feds are on his case. I mean, he knows they're compiling evidence and proof of his bad behavior.
Ah, but he can't do it because of his father.
Yes, his father is.
And when Uncle Alfredo tells him why his father has beaten up on him as a kid, it's like a shock.
Yes, yeah. Well, I think a character like Dante, there has to be a moment that liberates him.
Yeah.
He is in the process of making good his escape, and he's set it up very carefully. Then he meets Nora, and all of a sudden the whole story changes because he is completely smitten with her.
Yeah.
And then the question is, will she leave her life and go with him?
Yeah.
And we won't tell, right?
No, no. That's the lady or the tiger.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Do you always do something like that in a book?
I began multiple points of view with S's for Silence. First time I did it.
Yeah.
I knew in that book I was talking about Violet Sullivan, who had been missing for 34 years. And I thought, this is going to be so tedious. Kinsey Mulhone will interview everybody who knew Violet. She will never know who's telling the truth.
Yeah.
So it occurred to me, belatedly at my age, that I could go back in time let the reader see what really happened, yeah. and then watch Kinsey put the pieces together. Yeah. With Tears for Trespass, I had two points of view. Kinsey's and this very wicked, evil woman yeah. named Solana Rojas. You, I did maybe three or four points of view, but what I do, my goal is to let the book tell me. Mm-hmm. I don't make this up. I don't regulate yeah. it. I don't make rules and about my characters. I let them do what they need to do.
Yeah. But in between, is there a plot chart that you work?
Sometimes I do index cards, which yeah. is what Kinsey does, because if I get confused, yeah. what I've discovered is that it's easier to break a book down in terms of small scenes, just a few lines on an index card. If I'm looking at a chapter, you get kind of committed to what you've written.
Yeah.
And you know it's not right, but you can't bear to admit it. If I reduce it to lines on an index card, I can move things around and discover if I'm out of sequence.
One question. Have you had a problem with coyotes?
We have them in our neighborhood, and yeah. I am a great fan of coyotes. They are wily, and they're smart, and they go about their business. During a drought season up in Santa Barbara, yeah. the coyotes would come down and the mothers would teach their cubs how to catch cats and rabbits. And yeah. So I have a great admiration for them.
So I have a great admiration for you and this book. And as you can tell, I miss nothing.
Yes, that's right.
I loved it. Thank you. Will you autograph my book?
I will. If I may, I will put it in the big V.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson. And you can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. You can link in to Claremont Graduate University, where I have a feeling you can even find an early show that I did with Sue Grafton. But support your local library. Even Kinsey uses the library
yes.
to find out where people are living, what their phone number is. And so you never know who's going to be sitting next to you there. Could be another private eye. But all joking aside, support that library. They need all the help and donations you can give them. And we'll see you next time. Thank you, Sue.
It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.